Hello and welcome to Let's Play the Dagon DLC, the Railway Horror. I'm Amethyst Lunatari, the RPG chick. I played the main game as well a couple days ago. I played the DLC, the Little Glass Bottle, yesterday, if you're watching this when the day it comes out. And now we're going to be playing the Railway Horror. Just want to say, if you want to find any of my short games like this, and I have quite a few of them, because I play a lot of long games, obviously RPG games and such, so I like to put in some short games to try to balance things out a little bit. Anyway, here's the Railway Horror. Oh. This is not an official Lovecraft story, even though it may sound familiar to some of you. It's an excerpt from the writer's letter to his friend Donald Wandrei from November 24th, 1927, in which he described one of his dreams, or rather, a nightmare. I don't know. I think they should do the Mountains of Madness next, or at the Mountains of Madness. Humanitarian aid. This probably opens a website, so.
My dreams occasionally approached the fantastical in character, though falling somewhat short of coherence. One scene is especially stamped upon my recollection. That of a dank, fetid, reed-choked marsh under a gray autumn sky.
Okay, we're going that way. But always looking for little trivia things like this. Dreams and letters. In letters to his friend Donald Wandrei, Lovecraft described two of his dreams. After the writer's death, they were sold to the publisher of the Senti Snaps / Bizarre magazine and published in the form of short stories. The first one, titled The Very Old Folk, tells the story of one of the provinces of the Roman Republic and mysterious mountain inhabitants performing terrible rituals. The second one was titled The Thing in the Moonlight and was published in January 1941. The publisher added... Hold on. The publisher added a fabricated beginning and ending to it, in which Lovecraft, unable to free himself from the nightmare, mentally contacts a stranger. Other publishers later reprinted the story, unaware that some of the text was not authentic. It is this dream that we present here in its original form without any additions. Let's see if there's any other little symbols here. That might be it.
With a rugged cliff of lichen-crusted stone rising to the north.
Oh. We're not going there. I thought we were. We're going there. Oh, look at that. Is that some kind of scythe or something? Seems like a good spot to put a hidden symbol. Especially interested in this thing. Yeah, I'm not seeing anything else.
Impelled by some obscure quest, I ascended a rift or cleft in this beetling precipice.
A beetling precipice. Nothing else? I mean, I'm sure they'll have them at the end again, and I usually read the ones that I've missed. Just trying to get as many as possible.
noting as I did so the black mouths of many fearsome burrows extending from both walls into the depths of the stony plateau.
The author's voice. The protagonist whose fate you follow is Lovecraft himself. After all, it is an account of his dream. That's why we wanted to reproduce his way of speaking and accent as faithfully as possible. Unfortunately, no recordings of his voice have survived. That's why we had to rely only on descriptions from numerous letters. Friends remember his voice as high-pitched, thin, and flat. This guy doesn't sound like a high-pitched, really. However, it changed while reading or reciting, as the writer's wife, Sonia Green, recalls his voice then became stronger, clearer, and deeply resonant. Oh, okay, like this. Lovecraft spoke with a New England accent, which, as the writer himself mentioned, was characterized by the following. We don't sound any final R in words like ka, fa, and C. What's the NC? Phonetically, our common pronunciation is indistinguishable from ka, fa, and... Is this some kind of, like, formatting error or something? Selected letters, 3.420. In his youth, Lovecraft tested his singing skills and even recorded some of his rehearsals. My mother actually liked the results. Mothers are not always unbiased critics, but I saw to it that, in accident, soon removed the incriminating evidence. An accent. Later I tried something less ambitious. This was a better success, but reminded me so much of the way of a dying fox terrier that I very carelessly happened to drop it, the record, soon as after it was made. I have since confined my artistic talents to literature. H.P. Lovecraft to Maurice W. Moe, 15th of May, 1918. Nothing else, right? Okay.
At several points, the passage was roofed over by the choking of the upper parts of the narrow fissure.
The upper parts. I can hear it now.
These places being exceedingly dark and forbidding the perception of such burrows as may have existed there. In one such dark space, I felt conscious of a singular accession of fright. As if some subtle and bodiless emanation from the abyss were engulfing my spirit.
Never seen engulfing spelled that way.
But the blackness was too great for me to perceive the source of my alarm.
It almost looks like Cthulhu, like, slouched against the rock there. Like, if I kept moving, I can't go further, but I kept moving my cursor this way. It looks like an eye there, right over there. And, like, this looks like tendrils or tentacles coming down. But it might just be me reading too much into this.
At length, I emerged upon a tableland of moss-grown rock and scanty soil, lit up by a faint moonlight which had replaced the expiring orb of day. Casting my eyes about, I beheld no living object, but was sensible of a very peculiar stirring far below me amongst the whispering rushes of the pestilential swamp I had lately quitted.
Down there? I'm kind of nervous to be looking for clues right now, with trivia things. And I am not finding any, so I'm going to proceed. Oops. dreamlands. Dreams have often been an inspiration for Lovecraft. Dagon is a good example. Moreover, the writer often set the action of his stories in the dreamland, a separate world filled with unique places, creatures, and legends. This informal dream cycle includes stories written between 1918 and 1932, such as The Cats of Ulthar, The Doom That Came to Sarnath, Polaris, and The Silver Key. They show a slightly different side of the author of Call of Cthulhu and inspirations with the work of Lord Dunsany. The protagonist associated with Dreamlands is Randolph Carter, known from, among others, one of Lovecraft's longest stories, The Dream Quest of Unknown Kadath. It tells the story of Carter's journey through amazing lands in search of a wonderful city that appeared to him in his dreams. And that's the one where I mentioned where he went, you know, was basically in space and went to one moon or planet and there were cats, and then the other one had rats, and the cats were his friends and they talked to him and they gave him tips and stuff, trying to help him find this city. It's a very interesting story, not scary, but, you know, maybe has a few tense moments. But that's it. Alright, so we're going that way. Let's see if there's anything else to be seen. Oh, that. Like a door from a, like a spaceship or something.
After walking for some distance, I encountered the rusty tracks of a street railway and the worm-eaten poles which still held the limp and sagging trolley wire.
Trivia on this screen? Nothing. Surprising. Oh, it's actually moving. That's pretty cool. Oh, wait. Borrowed concepts. Lovecraft believed that authors could make their stories more credible by exchanging ideas and drawing from each other's works. The best example is the famous invented book Necronomicon, which also appeared in the works of his friends such as Robert Bloch, later creator of Psycho, and Robert E. Howard, creator of Conan the Barbarian. Its presence in the works of various other writers has even led to the mythologization of the Necronomicon and the appearance of references to the book in countless novels, films, and other works of pop culture. Lovecraft himself also used elements of other people's works, such as the books Unaspreklichen Kulten, Nameless Cults by Robert E. Howard, and De Vermis Mysteris, Mysteries of the Worm by Robert Bloch. Oh, did he change the name? But that's what he was referring to? Because I've heard that before, De Vermis Mysteris. So is it De Vermis Mysteris by Robert Bloch? Or Mysteries of the Worm? And he decided to put it in Latin to make it more, you know, mysterious. Haster, a creature borrowed from Robert W. Chambers, author of The King in Yellow, who was inspired by Ambrose Pierce, isn't it? Ambrose Pierce? They wrote Beers there. He also used his land of Carcosa, which later appeared in the TV series True Detective. The Sathagua, a creature invented by Clark A. Smith, Lovecraft slightly changed its appearance, including it in his stories. We wanted to follow this tradition, so we included objects from three other games created by our friends. I wonder if you will be able to recognize them. If there are other indie games and not extremely popular, I probably will not recognize them. This? Is this from another game that you guys are talking about?
Following this line, I soon came upon a yellow vestibuled car numbered 1852 of a plain, double-trucked type, common from 1900 to 1910.
Indeed it is. Nothing here, huh?
It was untenanted, but evidently ready to start.
Sounds like it's already running to me. Railway. The railway has always fascinated people. The mighty power of machines, the freedom to travel vast distances, the romanticism of almost unrestricted exploration, thousands of strangers passing each other every day, but also the desolate train stations, dreamlike journeys through the night, fatal accidents, and dangerous strangers. No wonder that this topic attracted horror and fantasy writers from Charles Dickens' The Signal Man, through Robert Bloch's award-winning The Hellbound Train, to Clive Barker's The Midnight Meat Train. Excellent. I've read The Midnight Meat Train. And seen the movie. The story is better. It's also impossible not to mention the most important Polish weird fiction writer, Stefan Grabinski, whose most famous collection of stories, The Motion Demon, is dedicated to the railway. You'll be able to get acquainted with his work through our next game. There we saw a preview of that at the end of the Dagon game. And by the way, the steam locomotive was first used to transport passengers in 1825. I wonder if it has anything to do with the number Dream by Lovecraft. Oh, yeah. Oh, it's just, like, transposed. Yeah, it might have been in his mind. It might have. Yeah, because dreams are subconscious anyway. So you're already connected with your subconscious mind through dreams.
The trolley being on the wire and the air brake pump now and then throbbing beneath the floor.
Anything to see? Probably not.
I boarded it and looked vainly about for the light switch.
Oh, sounds like one of those drums. I don't know exactly what it's called, but it's a kind of drum that you lay on your lap and play it, and it makes sounds like that. I've heard people play it before. It sounds rather spooky in this environment, though.
Noting as I did so the absence of controller handle, which implied the brief absence of the motorman. Then I sat down in one of the cross seats toward the middle, awaiting the arrival of the crew and starting of the vehicle.
Starting of the vehicle? Still looking for any symbols. I think it's been added in. I know it's the same scene. Alright, let's go sit down. Remember, this is a dream. Not everything's gonna make sense. Oh, there's another thing. We're starting to sound like I'm from Boston now. The Visit. In 1927, Donald Wandrei hitchhiked from Minnesota to Rhode Island to visit Lovecraft. Wow. Sometimes having to spend the night outdoors during the trip, over the course of more than 2 weeks, Lovecraft showed the guest around the most interesting places in his hometown of Providence and the surrounding area. They also went, among others, to Boston, where the writer wanted to show his friend the house, which partly inspired the story Pickman's Model. Unfortunately, it turned out that it had been demolished. However, the truly chilling, literally, event occurred later when another of Lovecraft's friends, James F. Morton, arrived. The three of them went to a store in Warren where they took part in an ice cream eating contest. Each of them tried as many as 28 types, and Lovecraft himself admitted that he ate about 25 liters of this delicacy. Oh no, 2.5 liters. Okay, that's a little better. A statement describing their feat was framed and hung on the walls of the store. Very interesting. What now? We look out at the rock?
Presently, I heard a swishing in the sparse grass toward the left and saw the dark forms of the two men looming up in the moonlight. They had the regulation caps of a railway company, and I could not doubt but that they were the conductor and motorman.
But they're not completely human, are they?
Then one of them sniffed with singular sharpness and raised his face to howl at the moon. The other dropped on all fours to run toward the car. I leapt up and at once raced madly out of that car.
Don't blame you. Symbols? Stuff? Are we gonna die if we wait too long? Probably not. Now you're out here with those things, though. Not sure if that was a good idea. Well, one of them's still over there. Dun 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 dun. Any symbols? Special things? Alright, let's run.
And away across endless leagues of plateau till exhaustion waked me.
Music ran out. Okay. No more trivia things. Oh, here we go again. Gotta run!
Doing this not because the conductor had dropped on all fours, but because the face of the motorman was a mere white cone, tapering to one blood-red tentacle.
Jeez. That's the one that howled? How do you howl out of a tentacle? Like that. Oh, that's it. Yeah, that was interesting. So every once in a while they come out with one of these DLCs, and this one is the latest one. Yeah, it's pretty sweet to play through this stuff. This is really interesting. I've been wanting to play Dagon for pretty much since it came out, but... Oh, I missed two trivias. Never got to it for one reason or another. I didn't make it last time because I got Bell's palsy a week before Halloween, so that was out. Alright, so we can see the two things we missed. Donald Wandrei. The recipient of the letter containing the story presented here had a significant impact on the career of the writer from Providence. One of Lovecraft's most famous stories, The Call of Cthulhu, was initially rejected by the publisher of Weird Tales magazine. Wandrei visited his office and made a small provocation during the conversation, suggesting that Lovecraft was looking for other magazines to expand his audience. After this visit, the nervous publisher decided to accept the story and then published it in 1928. Wow. That was a good idea to do that. Just like Lovecraft, Wandrei was interested in poetry. Among others, he created the Sonnets of the Moonlight Midnight Hours, a series which inspired the creator Dagon to write the famous sonnets Mushrooms of Yoggoth. I never read that. But his greatest merit was co-founding the Arkham House publishing house with August Derleth, which published Lovecraft works after the writer's death, contributing greatly to his current popularity. And finally, inspirations. I wonder where that was hiding. Like, are they in order? Like, this is at, like, the last few scenes? I didn't see anything. A man with a tentacle covering his face is a strong and disturbing motif. He must have been right on that scene where you see the tentacle guy. You may recognize this image, as this is how Nyarlathotep, a mysterious, powerful creature appearing in Lovecraft stories, was portrayed in the role-playing game Call of Cthulhu. A creature with a bloody tentacle howling at the moon became the most frequently depicted form of Nyarlathotep, although this is not how Lovecraft described it. The presented story also became the inspiration for the erotic macabre novel Trolley No. 1852 by Edward Lee. Yeah, it has the same numbers almost. Isn't it 852? So you just added a 1? Its hero is Lovecraft himself. He accepts a commission to write a specific type of story combining horror and sensual themes, which features the titular trolley and its terrifying motorman. Well, that's it. That is all. I hope you guys enjoyed. I wish you guys a happy Halloween. And see you guys in another Let's Play, I hope. Thanks again, and always, seek adventure.